Okay, everyone, welcome to April. Let's get started. We've got lots of stuff tonight, so it should be a fun, action-packed evening. So yeah, we have a mailing list and a Google Plus community, and oh, I should have updated this, because we also have a meetup now, thanks to the proceeds of our Java 8 tutorial day in Adib. And we post videos of our talks to our website at tjug.ca/videos. And thanks to our G+ community. Actually, this was a pretty thin month for Java news. We did have a Java 7 update. And I think the coolest thing about Java 7 update 55 is they've added a sponsors equals zero flag to the installer on Windows, which makes it not auto-install all the crapware.
What, really?
So, yeah. So you can just slip a sponsors equals zero in there, and you're good to go. Yeah. There are more random security policy tweaks about how often applet warnings come up that tell you not to use applets anymore. And as with previous releases, they've got a best before date now. So if you're on the internet and you try to run Java 7 update 55 after July 15th, it will tell you not to. And you'll have to click OK, because that's when the next update is scheduled for. Oracle's running a second instance of an online course that's free. It's not exactly free, because you kind of, to get the most out of it, you need to buy some Raspberry Pi hardware. But I think, Adib, did you say you signed up for this?
I signed up for it, but I haven't actually done any. I signed up for the March 31st, and that's didn't really do anything. And they didn't email me telling me it was starting. And I haven't figured out what the URL is that I go to find whatever they're doing. So.
Well, as you can see, they use really good, memorable URLs. That's the sign up URL there. Don't forget the fourth colon between the zero and the P. they're starting a second one on May 19th, because the first one actually was fully enrolled and they wanted to get more people in. So I'm planning on signing up for this one. I'm interested in doing that. I want to automate my beer fermentation temperature controller, Java. There's a survey out. It's live right now on SurveyMonkey about dynamic proxies. So if you've ever used the built-in dynamic proxy feature in the Java standard library, you should fill out this survey, because they're looking to improve it for a future release of Java. I think we mentioned this. We didn't have a slide. I looked back through our previous notes. This was news from March, actually, that there was a JDK enhancement proposal for collection literals, like being able to specify a list, a map, or a set in code using syntax like most other languages have. And they have decided not to pursue it. So no collection literals for us. This is the tiny type here. It goes, these are the reasons that were outlined by Brian Goetz on the Lambda dev list in March. They've decided to go with static default methods on the collection interfaces called of. So it'll be a lot like if you've ever used Guava to build immutable collections. That's basically the idea that they're going for. There's still questions around how you would do maps, because the other things, like list of comma separated thing with vargs, or set of comma separated thing with vargs, make sense. Maps are a bit more awkward, because you need key value, and there's no syntax separating the key value pairs from each other. So that's not completely set in stone, but they have set in stone the decision not to add it to the language. So, I don't know, I'm personally a little bit disappointed, but they say that it would be way more trouble than it's worth, I guess. Yeah. And of course, there was Harpley. This is the first time we've had a security slide that's not about a Java vulnerability. This one was about sending dirty buffers out over the internet. So yay us for using a bounds-checked language, I guess. This is a patch. Christian pointed me at it. I hadn't looked it up, but he mentioned that he did. So they've accidentally just mallocked the size of the incoming payload in the heartbeat request. So that 1 plus 2 plus payload plus padding is matches the size of the received heartbeat request. And the fix was to malloc the amount of space it takes to write out a heartbeat response. So basically, it allocated a buffer the size of the request, wrote a fixed length heartbeat reply, and then sent the entire allocated buffer out. And the trailing part that was never written to just had old data in it from the stack, or from the heap, actually, not the stack. So there's a honest mistake that is very easy to make if you're programming in C or other languages that give you allocated buffers with old data in them. So yay us this month. But I think we've got about another 10 of these to go before we catch up.
The moral of the heartbeat story is stop writing software in C.
Yes. Yeah, we don't need to we don't need to write software in C anymore. It's fine. The Java calendar remains a good resource for seeing what's going on around the world in terms of Java and conferences. So check that out for sure. It's got lots of stuff in it. And any other news? I'm sure I must have missed something because I couldn't find too much this month.
I don't know if they're coming out with a new version. I believe this is the first version, because it originally came out in 2012. So I mean, it's current, but when you read it, you sort of have to suppress a quiet chuckle or two when they're all excited about the exciting new world of Java 7. Next slide. So the book describes a mixture of topics under four general headings. First of all, what's new and exciting in Java 7. Then a section dealing with sort of programming in the small, low-level techniques. Then what they call polyglot programming, which is these alternative JVM languages. And finally, larger scale project level issues. Next slide. So if we go through the table of contents quickly, chapter one deals with what's new in Java 7. This is where we meet multi-catch and try with resources, diamond operator, and things like that. Chapter two is about the new I/O libraries. This is where they discuss how to deal with path, directories, and files, and how to do asynchronous I/O. Chapter three is about the new JSR 330 standard, unifying dependency injection. Chapter four is about concurrency, starting with the block structured concurrency that we all know and love, and then moving on to more advanced topics like atomic types, locks and queues, and finally the fork join framework for dividing large tasks. It then dives down into the structure of class files and bytecode, stuff I really, really hope I never need to know in detail. It talks about a tool called Java P, which is used to disassemble class files, and it describes how to interpret the output, which looks pretty strange at first sight. Then chapter six talks about performance tuning. This was a pretty impressive chapter to me because it goes from a very high level where it's talking about what your goals should be, to a very low level, very nitty gritty treatment that talks about things like nano time, granularity differences across platforms, and how you need to be aware of the behavior of the garbage collector and just-in-time compiler when you're creating tests. But they don't start there. They start by saying, okay, your performance sucks. You need to start by figuring out what you're trying to accomplish, how you're going to build tests that measure that consistently, and know when you're done so you don't try to optimize forever. Next slide, please. The next four chapters talk about these alternative JVM languages. If you've never, there are dozens and dozens of these languages. It's a very popular area. But these three are the ones that seem to keep coming up. If you've never heard about them before, I'm a little curious how you came to be here. But just to summarize very quickly, Groovy is a very concise language, a dynamic language, so you don't have to declare types. It's sort of like Python or maybe Perl. Scala tries to bridge the gap between object-oriented programming and functional programming with a definite emphasis on the functional. And Clojure is Lisp, if you don't have enough parentheses in your life. With the emphasis being that this is Lisp that can interoperate easily with Java. Chapter 11 talks about test-driven development, why it's a good idea, why you might want to do it, how you do it. Chapter 12 is about building and verification and continuous integration. The tools they talk about are Maven and Jenkins, because I guess Ant and Cruise Control are last generation.
Even Maven is last generation, no? It's all about Gradle now.
Gradle?
Yeah.
Heavens.
Yeah.
Okay, things have moved on in two years, or maybe three if they wrote in 2011.
Yeah.
Let's see, where was I? So chapter 13 talks about rapid web development. The idea here is that there can be a trade-off in the frameworks that you use between, on the one hand, flexibility and performance, and on the other hand, succinctness and time to market. They're thinking that these environments that are focused on speed could at least be used for prototyping to get something up and running quickly.
Does it mention, I'm just curious which frameworks they refer to when on the spectrum of speed, let's say.
They have a graph here. I probably couldn't pull it out quickly.
That's fine. Yeah.
The two they really talk about are Grails, which is based on Groovy, and Composure, which is a Clojure system. And then the final chapter looks ahead to Java 8, which has now arrived, and even beyond that. For example, they talk about tuples, which we don't have yet. Next slide.
Yes.
So, all of this adds up to a bit of an odd duck. The common thread to all of this is that, first of all, it's all about Java, or at least the JVM, and second of all, none of this is for beginners. This book is definitely directed towards people who not only know Java, but probably know Java pretty well, so that you'll be interested in and can get something out of discussions of these fairly esoteric topics. I like the book. I feel like I really got something out of it, but I definitely wouldn't recommend it to beginners. In terms of difficulty, I think it's at about the same level as Brian Goetze's book about Java concurrency. It's about that difficult. And the net is that I recommend the book. It's good. I think you'll get something out of it. I also have a copy here that I can lend out if you want to bring it back to me next time. Any questions? Okay.
Thank you. Hey guys, so my name is Dimitri, as I mentioned earlier. This is my first time attending, actually, this meetup, let alone presenting. So what kind of time slot, by the way, am I looking at, like 45 minutes to an hour, or?
As long as you want.
Yeah, we usually aim for 45.
45, all right.
Today there's no one after us, so.
Okay. I'll try to keep it concise if the questions keep coming. The only reason I agreed to this is because Adib promised to buy everyone a beer tonight. Got us. All right, fine, okay. So, and tonight we're gonna talk about multi-tenancy. Actually, so first a quick survey. So Spring and Hibernate, everyone here heard about it slash worked with it, right? Anybody not heard of Spring or Hibernate? All right, okay, so that'll be easy. All right, so first I wanted to try to define what multi-tenancy is. And this particular definition I actually got from Hibernate reference documentation. And This particular definition states that multi-tenancy in general is applied to software development to indicate an architecture in which a single running instance of an application simultaneously serves multiple clients. To me, this is a good definition of what multi-tenancy is, but it doesn't define a tenant very well. So based on that definition, can anybody tell me why Facebook cannot be, let's say, considered a multi-tenant app? I don't know, should I supposed to be asking questions or?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. All right, so why do you think Facebook is not a multi-tenant app?
Well, because they're not also running another separate social network with different set of users on the same system.
Right, and exactly. And to me, for some reason, this, so maybe I'm slow, but for me, this definition doesn't capture it. So to me, multi-tenancy is when I sign up for an app, and to me, my experience is as if I have the whole instance of an app all to myself. So Yammer, I think that's how you pronounce Yammer, is actually a good example of a multi-tenant app. Because once I sign up for it, I can create my own users within it. I can create my own rules, my own filters, and they will not interfere with other users, with other tenants within Yammer. Salesforce is another very good example. Jira is another multi-tenant app. So any questions about what we're going to be talking about, what multi-tenancy is and what a tenant is and what kind of applications these are? All right, that's pretty clear, right? Yeah. All right, so while talking about multi-tenancy, I'm gonna base it on my experience. So I worked for a startup years ago, and we sort of hit a scaling limit, and we started thinking about how to address it. And we heard about these multi-tenancy things. We thought they were cool, and there was nothing out of the box offered, and we implemented, we think, sort of one of the first multi-tenancy apps. And then when Hibernate and Spring came along and they started offering multi-tenancy support out of the box, we sort of migrated over. So the application that I'm going to be talking about, the initial architecture was something like that. Each customer in our environment would get its own web application. So we would package a WAR. If we would sign up a new customer, we would deploy a new WAR on a Tomcat, we would create a new database, and they would truly be separate tenants. There would be nothing common about them but the code base. The stack was something like that, pretty typical, I think, for those days. Java, Tomcat, Spring, Hibernate, Struts, JSP, MySQL, and probably half a dozen to a dozen other frameworks. It was like a typical legacy onion application. You name a framework, it was probably there. So what was the result of this kind of setup? We would have about 20 applications in production. They were 95% the same. It was the same code base with minor sort of customizations, running on a single Tomcat. Huge memory overhead, 20 web app class loaders, same classes loaded over and over again, 20 sets of them. Hard drive overhead, not so much an issue. Hard drive disk space is cheap. Hard to monitor and deploy. And how do we scale? This is a real number. At about 25 instances, we would hit sort of a memory limit, I think on an 8 gigabyte machine. Hard to scale. Slack pace is okay, or? Yeah, all right.
When was it? How long ago?
Okay, so this setup we had about 7 years ago. The scaling limit we had about sort of 5.5, 6 years ago when we actually started thinking about, okay, what do we take it? And this was sort of a very typical organic growth. The startup, you have one customer, then you have another customer. What's the easiest thing to do? You drop another deploy, here's your instance. Then you get two more customers, and then you actually, before you realize you have a real company, you have to start sort of dealing with scaling issues. So when we heard about multi-tenancy, we quickly found out that there was absolutely no support out of the box for anything like that. But the problem was not new. Somebody already started thinking about multi-tenancy. Somebody already coined the term multi-tenancy. And there were articles on multi-tenancy at a very sort of high level, kind of abstract level. Exhibit A, there's an article in MSDN. This is probably the first article that's going to come up if you just type in multi-tenancy in Google, or at least it's on the first page. It's quite old. I think it's, I could be wrong, but I think it's mid-90s, maybe even earlier. And in this article, they actually describe three approaches, three best approaches to multi-tenancy. And these approaches are separate database. So you have a single application serving multiple databases, and each tenant lives in its own database. It's pretty simple. You can go with a separate schema approach, pretty close to separate database, but all your tenants are in the same database, and you separate them by schema. And the third and last approach that they suggest is a shared schema. How do you achieve a shared schema approach? You dump all of your data in the same tables, and you have a discriminator. So every table that houses your tenant's data has a column that identifies which tenant this record belongs to. We're going to talk about the trade-offs a bit later, but I can touch on them briefly right now. What happens is you have a bit of a spectrum here, where on the left-hand side, where the separate DB approach is, you have data that's as isolated as possible. You can have separate users. You can have dedicated users for each tenant. So one tenant can never access another tenant's data. In the middle, you have a separate schema where the security is still sort of pretty, you know, pretty strong, but it's not as obviously as isolated as the one on the left. And then you have a shared schema. Easier to scale. You're not constrained by the limits of some databases, by how many databases you can create on a single server. But your data, you got to be very careful. Your data from one tenant is in the same table as in another, and it's separated by basically one of the columns, by a value in one of the columns. Any questions so far on what the options are, why there are not more options? Anybody has an idea for maybe a fourth option? Anything else maybe they missed?
The shared schema thing worries me because it would make SQL injection attacks even worse.
So I agree. When we were sort of contrasting these approaches, I couldn't in my mind come up with an approach with sort of with a logic that would ensure that sort of data cross-tenant sort of contamination would never happen. Mm-hmm. It would seem so easy to get to miss something and boom, you get your tenants. SQL injection is just one of them. Any other sort of advantage? Yeah?
I guess a variation of the shared schema would be different tables.
Yeah.
So depending on the customer.
That's true. That is a fourth approach. Tables. Yeah.
That seems fairly similar to separate schema.
Yeah.
But it is different because you can have the same schema but different tables, and you can have a master table that points, go to this table for this customer, and you can have some sort of a, that's true. Yeah?
If you go the other way, you go like all the way to separate VMs per customer and not even share operating systems.
That's true.
I've seen that happen as well.
Yeah.
When you're trying to address scalability, what does it really mean? So you're saying that, for example, one customer demand more and more data, more and more space.
That's actually an excellent question.
Yeah, so then probably separate database is a way to go because then you need to move out other customers to other databases.
Yeah. So
what's the reason to share the schema if you're actually trying to address scalability?
Maybe it's more about scaling up the number of customers.
Yeah.
If you have completely separate
But this is a very good question. So I think when you consider these approaches, you actually have to try to estimate your typical customer. So if you're dealing with hundreds and hundreds of customers that have very, very little data, for example, 20 records your typical customer might have. Let's say they sign up, they create two users, and then, I don't know, they play Tetris, all day, and there's no trail, there's no logging. Then I could actually see how shared schema could be an advantage. You don't want to be creating 200 databases, pay the price of an overhead, and only, I have very little data for each database. With a shared schema, You know what I mean? So, but it's a very good question. I think when you have to ask these questions about your typical customer when you assess this.
So for you, scalability means more customers on one server rather
yes.
than one customer demands a lot of data, a lot of resources.
So for us, our biggest customer, I think, was actually 300,000 records, and everybody else was below that. So we wanted to be able to have, 100, 200, 300 customers. They're still fairly small. It's not 200 records, but it's very small data sets. I'll get to sort of, the next slide actually explains why we went with what we went, but, and maybe actually I'll get there on the next slide. But to answer your question, yes, when I say scalability, I mean customers per server.
Okay,
yeah.
Also, it has regulation issues. Some, if you work for the government,
yes.
they require your data has to be in Canada, or your data has to be in US.
Yeah, you're hitting all my points from the next slide. So. But yeah, so I was going to mention contractual agreements. So actually, one of the biggest deciding factors for us was the contractual obligation. We wanted to be in the position where we come to our customer, we say, you know what? Your data is in a separate database. If you want, and some customers wanted it, we'll assign a read-only user to you. You can access it. We didn't encourage that, but some customers wanted it. And that was a big, yeah, it was a big selling point. And of course, on top of that, you can have even stricter regulations where, well, I can't have my data shared and I cannot have it overseas. Yeah.
Yeah. This is new, but you can also try the new microservices architectures.
Microservices.
You no longer deploy a giant WAR file. Uh-huh. What you do is you deploy a lot of individual single services that are maybe 1,000 to 2,000 lines of code.
Okay.
And then they have their own view of the data. So, for example,
you have
like the usernames might be in the user service.
Yeah.
And it's like, okay, these things need to be separate, so they go. But you would, within those, you would still have all those three options.
Yeah, I've heard about this approach. It's very counterintuitive to me. I actually worked on a prototype using Drop Wizard that did exactly that.
Right.
You would have user service that has only users table underneath it, and that's all it has access to. No referential integrity, some other service, which let's say, email client, would reference a user, but would have no primary foreign key restraint, and it would have but you're right. Within each one of those, you think you'd still have to choose. Oh, I love it. Two more approaches we came up with, so there's five. Somebody should contact Microsoft, and we'll add those. Okay. Sorry?
You said it was in the 90s, right?
Yeah, I know, but you know what? It's still one of the most popular articles. Like, it still comes up, and it was very good. All right, so why did we go with this? So I'm going to try to go with this pretty quick because we touched on all of these. So we wanted the highest possible degree of isolation, mostly contractual reasons. We just touched on that. Strong security, dedicated users per tenant, also nice to have. This is typically discouraged in a multi-tenancy applications. You don't want to do anything specific for a tenant because it quickly becomes a maintenance nightmare. You don't want to have 1,000 tenants and keep track of, well, on this tenant, I threw this index on this table. But we did want to have that ability because some customers really demanded custom store procedures and... Sorry? It's actually true. Yes, they were high-paid customers. We danced around them. Again, it's a startup. Sorry?
I'll be like a hostile witness. Why wouldn't you want that?
So to be a devil's advocate. So I think to sort of from a profitability point of view, you want to have as many customers as possible with little, requiring as little maintenance as possible. If this becomes a trend, if I come to customers and I say, listen, we'll give you this instance, it's out of the box, but if you have some sort of custom business processes, we'll throw in a store procedure, we'll throw in a custom JSP, we'll write a custom module for you. When we add a new module to our core base, we'll not have to do all this regression testing. Let's say we have six customers that use custom functionality. We'll not have to make sure that this custom functionality works with them. It's a little bit painful to write automated tests for all these sort of different customers. Sometimes you forget, or we threw this index, so it has an unexpected side effect, things like that.
You sort of move from being a SaaS company to a consulting company.
Exactly. You become basically a professional services company where your main revenue becomes, I'm going to trade my time for your dollars. And
sure. I mean, I think just like how you showed on the database side, there's a spectrum. I think even at this level, there's a spectrum too. Mm-hmm. Because if you look at, for example, Salesforce, they allow you to create, you know, entities on the fly, and you can say, you know, which columns are indexed on the fly. You know, they build a whole layer on top of, I think it was Oracle, I don't know if it's still Oracle now,
yeah.
But they build a database on.
Salesforce is like a meta, the entire thing is yeah. It's a unique SaaS.
Yeah, it's a god of SaaS to me. We copied actually lots of stuff from them. But they do that, most of the things they do, most of these customizations, don't they do that using their own scripting language?
They do, it's their own language, that's right.
Yeah, so this I actually don't consider a true customization because you give them your own language, you define the rules for how these customizations are defined, how they're stored, and you can test those contracts. And then they can write whatever they want as long as you test the interface and contracts.
I guess that's what I mean by a spectrum, because on one end, it's a static schema, you got to fit into this block, and on the end, you have almost like a virtual machine that understands the different customers. Yeah.
But you say it's really configuration versus customization, right? Like when you do that in Salesforce, there's not a Salesforce engineer going and changing code, right?
You know,
they built it into the system to allow.
It's just text files, right? Like whether it gets compiled into Java or it's scripted.
But the application is already able to process
yeah.
it.
So I think actually, I think that's how I actually, now that you voiced it, I think how I differentiated. When we introduce the scripting language, again, we introduce means for you to write a little text file with scripts, save it somewhere, and then run it using the objects that you expose to that scripting engine. And those objects I can test. I can control what I expose and what I don't expose. And I think, yeah, I would be able to actually automatically test this. But I still agree with the point, yeah, it's a spectrum. It depends on your sort of revenue, how you want to make money. Some companies, you know, these professional services is a big part of their model.
Yeah, I think the professional services is a good point.
Yeah.
But it's sort of blurring now because, you know, you could have a customer go and spin up their own Docker instance or something and customize parameters to that level, so.
I missed this last part. From the scripting engine?
Well, like saying they want to spin up, like start their own, you know, customize, you know, Pentaflow, for example, right? And mm-hmm. them creating, you know, through your admin interface, you know, you could actually allow them to change your connection pool settings and then spin up a lightweight instance for you, right? So I think this, you know, as we move along, things are, the lines are blurring.
Yeah. You have to. Even each customization, we obviously, if we didn't think it made sense, we try to push back. Even if, you know, a lot of money was thrown at us. These are sort of the considerations, I think, when you introduce a scripting language. Yeah, you got to be very careful what you want to expose, what kind of functionality of your core system you have to expose.
Can I ask what's your average customer paying per month?
You know what, not of this, so maybe sort of you averse, you know, you're overestimating my importance at that company, so I didn't have Right.
We always hear about when you look up anything on.
So,
right?
this pricing model, it was a per user license model. So, I think based on my little research, $50 to $75 per user was their going rate. However, for big customers, it would go as low as 25. So, if the customer would come in and they would have 400 users, they would pay a lesser rate.
Because I think, like, you know, the old model, which is where our business came from, you know, companies would pay six figures for an installation, you customize it.
That's true.
Now, in the SaaS model, often companies are looking at spending a couple hundred dollars a month.
That's true.
It's very difficult.
That's a very good point.
To support hundreds of different configurations when there's no upfront payments and $300, $500 a month.
That's actually, so this was true. The initial cost, the setup cost, I think was like $5,000. So, very good point, yeah. So, they would ask for a customization. We would tell them, okay, this is how much you pay. And they would pay for this customization, but then the pain of maintaining it, we would never reimburse. would always live with this pain of having this customization for the tenant. And it's true, it's this new age price model. And it's actually, this is a repeat. We wanted to have an ability to meet tenants' individual needs, maybe some performance tuning. That's basically customization. Direct access, we mentioned that. A few of our customers wanted that. And of course, because we had separate applications already and separate databases, for us going that route meant that we only change the application and at least all of our databases stay the same. And why are you smiling? You don't think it's a good reason? Oh, I thought you were. No, I thought you were. Okay, never mind. I thought you smiled because like we cheated, because it's not a real reason. It's not a very sort of pure reason. Basically, all we have it fits nice. But all the other ones, I think, are correct.
Well,
all right.
One other thing that you get that is that you don't have other tenants affecting other tenants' performance, right? So if someone's,
that's true.
If someone's doing some heavy read or write operations, you're not going to slow down the rest of your customers.
That's true. So that would be a case with a shared schema, right? You can actually get, if somebody's writing. You're hitting the same, yeah.
So would you say separate database models? Are they running on the same server?
Yeah, actually, so our model, yeah, they're running on the same server, and you have, I definitely see, yeah, it's actually a good point. On the shared schema, you can be locking other customers. If you have an exclusive locks, especially with SQL Server, with their sort of lock escalation model, yeah, you can run into this problem.
But even with your approach, you're still IO bound. If one customer doing a lot of reads,
Yeah, but I'm bound now by the CPU, right? I'm not bound by the lock resolution mechanism in particular, yeah. It's easier to resolve those by just throwing hardware at it. All right, so what do we take this from here? Now that we selected this sort of high-level approach, what do we actually do? How do we actually implement it? This code doesn't work. I just sort of threw it together, but we'll look at it anyway. So people are familiar with Spring here, and that, like, everybody understands that this is just a Spring sort of definition of beans, right? Yeah, it's probably pretty good. So once you went with, once you chose your model, and in our case, we chose a separate database model approach, the next day, we could basically do something like this. And what it is just, it's two definitions of a section factory, section factory customer one and section factory customer two, that injects different data sources, which are also defined separately for each customer. This is clear, right? I have six customers. I define six data connection pools, six session factories, and then we'll get to what we do from this. But obviously, you write some sort of a class or some sort of a dispatcher that decides which customer to go to based on some information that's stored either in the thread or in the session. This was actually something pretty close to that was our first prototype. We threw a customer token on a session. So a customer would log in. We threw a customer identifier in the session. And then marked the thread. And when we were about to read something or write something to the database, we would use that information to select the correct connection pool. And we would go to that and extract and return. So if you had a bug in a connection pool.
Yeah, if you picked the wrong connection pool, then.
Oh, yeah. No, of course, that's a good point. Let's go back. Once you chose this isolated approach, separate databases, you cannot declare, oh my god, there's nothing I can do that the data would now never leak from my customer to another. You can mess it up pretty bad in the application layer. I can go to the wrong connection pool. I can pick the wrong user. Yeah, that's true. So this is it, guys. This is the end of the presentation. Basically, that's how you implement multi-tenancy. So this is a joke, but this was actually said. This line was thrown around at one of the meetings when we did the prototype. That probably another month, another couple of weeks, and we'll be good. Like, this is so easy. Sorry, you had a question? No. I gotta stop trying to like read people too much. I have all these signs and nothing is happening. You weren't smiling, you didn't have a question. So we have some unresolved issues actually. First one, well, we need to either make our DAOs aware of multi-tenancy or have a proxy and constantly inject various session factories at runtime into the DAO or something along those lines. Does this actually point make sense? Because we have various session factories, we have multiple session factories per tenant, you can no longer have a singleton. Typically you have a DAO and you have a single instance of a session factory and you inject them. With what I showed in the previous slide, well, you can't really do that because I have, you know, 6 or 10 or 20 of them, and which one do I invoke? So you have to deal with that. That's a don't use a singleton. Yeah, okay, but instantiate, and so which scope would you go with? You cannot use a singleton, and actually you can do this presentation. It's true, you cannot use a singleton anymore, but which scrape, you cannot use a prototype because instantiating a connection pool is very expensive. Instantiating a session factory is even more expensive. So you need some sort of a storage. You need some sort of a storage, and we'll get to that. That's how we address that issue, because we can't do prototype, we can't do singleton, but we can do something in the middle.
Sorry, why can't you use a singleton?
So typically, you can have a singleton DAO, and you would inject a singleton session factory into it. You would just have to wire it. But in our previous slide, I defined multiple session factories. I defined a session factory for each customer. Yeah.
I didn't get that. Okay.
Yeah. So when I have a DAO now and I want to, which session factory do I inject? Which session factory do I want to execute queries on or Hibernate selects? You can basically write a class that says, and that's what we did. Well, what's my token? My token is this customer. I'm going to go to some storage. I'm going to get the right connection pool and I'm going to start operating. But it's a bit of an issue because you don't want to write multi-tenant code all over the place. You kind of want your application to be multi-tenancy oblivious kind of thing.
When you said it was stored in the thread, I thought that's where the things could always come from.
Oh, sorry.
Regardless of what mean it's being used. Like that's where the customer or tenant ID would come from, right?
Yeah, so the tenant ID would store in a thread, okay. Nothing else. So when we would auto wire DAOs and session factory, we'd still need to the thread is marked, but we still need to use that information to make that connection between the DAO and the session type.
And the database connection wasn't like named based on the customer's ID?
When you mean database connection, so we have a pool, we have an object, and it's a data source.
Yeah.
It's of type data source. You have to somehow link them together. At the end, yes, we had a means of giving something a token. Free time cafe, give me the connection tool for it. So we would assign a token to not only connection pool, but all the other objects that we needed for this customer to run. Because connection pool is one, session factory is one, and we had a few kind of almost singletons. They're not singletons, but we needed this object for the customer to work. And the other sort of issue is, it would be nice to have some sort of a customer scoped objects, the object that exists as long as this customer is alive and functional. This will make more sense, this particular line, because we're going to talk about customer scope. And the biggest problem actually for us, I should have asked the question, what the biggest problem, damn it, okay. Even with this line, should I pull definitions for each customer? Difficult to manage. Can anybody think of what does that mean actually for us as a sort of an operations? We're trying to keep a business running and uptime is very important. What does that mean with this setup that we cannot do when we, let's say, sign up a new customer? Exactly. And that was really, really troublesome. Yeah, you have to. A new customer comes in, yay, okay, we signed a check. Okay, let me go run a sort of procedure, create a new database. Find sort of a clean kind of slate database. Okay, let's do that. Let me go edit the XML. Okay, let me stay up till 3 o'clock and deploy it. oh shit, this customer didn't come up for some reason, oh, because it's customizations, we did this for this customer. This was probably the biggest issue, the fact that you cannot dynamically introduce new customers.
Is the connection pool allocated at startup as well? Like you run into connection issues with your database?
So you have an option. It's how you want to implement it. So initially we had eager initialization. So we would start up an app and we would try to initialize every single connection pool, because if we couldn't, at least it would tell us there's something wrong with the database. Once you start reaching, you know, decent numbers, 50 customers, 70 customers, the startup time, you just can't wait. So you go with a lazy initialization. So the customer's sitting there idle. When the very first user hits that tenant, you start initializing it in the frenzy. If you can't, you know, an email gets sent out. But you have that option. We initially had the eager, and then we went with the lazy. As far as the open connections, we saw no issues with having two initial connections, let's say. So connection pool with two open connections to start with, per database, up to 1,200 databases on a server. No issue. You have, I mean, it's a little lame. You have, you know, 2,400 open connections, but no issues. We then reduced it to zero because we realized, well, the user hits it, you know, the user leaves, you probably want to shrink the pool. You don't want to have these two open connections there for no reason. Any other questions at all on the previous slides? Multi-tenancy, should we define multi-tenancy again? No? No? All right. All right. So we didn't go to production with this. We decided that these are pretty big issues for us and we need to try to address it. How are we doing, Tom? How long have we been talking for? Well, half an hour? Oh, shit. Okay. All right. So we're going to speed it up. So we did a lot more work. We actually addressed those issues in our sort of own kind of way. We wrote lots of custom code. We sweared with no documentation. We introduced Spring, basically, classes that would shadow the real classes. We had all sorts of mess. But then around 2012, the company was actually acquired by that time already, but around 2012, Hibernate and Spring came out with out-of-the-box support for multi-tenancy. Nobody gets excited about that, no? Like this was huge. Sorry, I should rephrase this. In 2012, Hibernate starts claiming that they support multi-tenancy out-of-the-box. I'm actually, I think, like, I'm a fairly conservative kind of developer. When new things come out, I don't touch them for 2 years. But this, I don't know, this sort of really, I don't know, really got to me. I try to sell it that we should, you know, migrate, and we tried. All right. So we're going to now look at how these two frameworks actually implement multi-tenancy. So this is, you know, this is stuff that you can, you know, use today, and it works. We're going to talk about the things that work and don't. So Hibernate 3 multi-tenancy support. Out-of-the-box support for these three approaches. So this article or this consensus that existed for years, they just went ahead and implemented it. Same three things. Things to consider when picking a strategy, we already went through this. And this, okay, this looks like a lot of code, but I decided to put in here because hybrid documentation makes it so simple. It basically gives you this. This is all you need to look at. And this is basically a multi-tenancy implementation. So it almost makes it seem that you got to put these three lines in your session factory config. And again, session factory is this main object, you know, in Hibernate where you configure everything. You want to say, oh, I want to use multi-tenancy. You got to make your selection here. This is which class I want to go to when I want to know which customer I'm currently running as. Simple. We already have a thread. Like, this is all done already. And this is the class that Hibernate is going to go to when it wants to fetch a connection. It's not going to know which connection to fetch. It's just going to ask you, give me a connection. And it's up to the developer to figure out which tenant I'm currently running is and which connection to fetch.
So that's a class that you as a developer
run? Yeah. And so I'm going to show. It's two interfaces that you implement. One is the tenant identifier resolver. How do I figure out, because Hibernate is going to call me back, how do I figure out which tenant I'm in right now? This thread that I'm running, that I'm about to execute some operation, how do I know that? And it needs to do that because it does all sorts of a synchronization. You know how it puts a connection pool and a session factory on a thread in Spring when you run things. And the second class that you give Hibernate is simple multi-tenant connection provider. Hibernate is going to call this when it needs a connection, and it's going to give you, we're going to look at it, it's going to give you a tenant identifier. And you have to figure out how to fetch the connection from the data source and return it. So this is, any questions here? So on the next slides, I go over this. But again, three configuration lines and two interfaces you got to implement. It seems like it's really, really simple.
What is another option than database?
Oh, so it's these three options. You can say schema, and you can say, I think it's partitioned. Yeah, yeah. So, and again, and these two are the same. The resolver will stay the same, and your connection provider might change because you might have to do some extra trickery if you're on a shared schema. Any other questions on these configuration parameters, or does it make sense? Does it seem simple? Like, if you saw this, would you think this is easy? I thought it'll be done in a week. Yeah, it does seem simple because everything else stays the same. They want you to believe.
And you don't need to change any of the Spring stuff.
So Spring.
Right,
so Spring's support for multi-tenancy was more of a Spring support for integrating with Hibernate that supports multi-tenancy. Okay. They didn't actually sort of introduce anything because out of the box with Spring, you get the transaction manager, let's say. Transaction manager for multi-tenant app is a little bit different, and I'll talk about that. And actually, the summary doesn't work. They introduced the integrated transaction manager, which still doesn't work. You actually need a JTA transaction manager. I'll mention that, which is a huge, I think, disadvantage. Because there are very few JTA transaction managers out there outside of the application server. There's Atomicos, and there's one more. But you have to use it. And there's a little sort of small print in the documentation on the side. You know those little boxes that you never read on the side? It's actually there. Oh, you'll need a JTA transaction manager. All right. So. Here, I don't know, I'll try. I don't know how to do this. Should we look at the code or should we just look at this? So the first interface that you have to implement is this tenant identifier resolver. It's very simple. Oh, that's small. It's very simple. This is the interface, and you just got to implement a couple of callback methods. Resolve current tenant identifier. This, I mean, it could be a random, it could be sort of random generated, you know, sort of. Sorry, was there? No? Anything funny or?
No, he's just pointing out that the Java doc is stupid because it's just the same as the method name.
Yeah. It's repeating the method name twice.
It's doing what twice, sorry?
No, like the Java doc is useless. It doesn't really tell you what to do there.
Oh, the fact that it says resolve the current tenant identifier? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. No, it's true. This is a tip of the iceberg. Like, I encourage you to go to Hibernate documentation and look at this like multi-tenancy. And again, that's why I was completely misled. I'm like, it basically just works. But yes, good observation. But this method again, very simple. If your thread is marked. And of course, you got to implement that thread marking. We luckily had it. But if you're starting from scratch, you have to build a mechanism that the user logs in, you identify which tenant it is, you store that somewhere, thread, session, anywhere. And then here, you got to extract it. Validate existing current session. To be honest, I forgot what it is. Should we validate the tenant identifier that already exists? This is the important one. And this one, I think we just returned true. Oh, yeah. Matches the value you turn here, yeah.
What is the validate existing current session supposed to do?
So, Jonathan just mentioned it.
I think it's just whether or not you want it to police you to make sure that you haven't returned a different value from resolve current tenant identifier from one call to the next within the same session.
So in this case, actually, the Java doc seems to be helpful. Yeah, it just, you know, it, it tries to match it up. So this is the first interface that you implement, and the second one is this simple multi-tenant connection provider. This interface is a little bit more involved. There's a few methods. Get any connection. That's the connection where you don't really care which tenant it is. Anybody can think why would you want to do that? Why would you want to implement a get any connection within the multi-tenant app? You can see it in the docs. Nobody look at the docs. But yeah. And that's exactly why, because Session Factory, in order to start up, it does all sorts of schema validation. And it doesn't really care which tenant you give it, because it wants to ensure that your schema that you define in your Hibernate entities is correct. That makes sense. Release any connection, so it's going to pass in that connection. Maybe you want to do something special. And then get connection, and I'm going to tell you which tenant I want this connection for. Release it. And supports aggressive release. So again, nothing really hard here, right? You basically, this is a contract for how to fetch a connection. Any questions on these? Adib, you got to give me feedback. You do this all the time. Like, cover more, I don't know. Yeah, you're good, all right. So, so how you identify the tenant. So let's define identify.
Yeah.
So what do you mean how we identify the tenant? So.
No, I'm waiting, that's the part I'm waiting for.
No, but I'm trying to understand what the question is. So
here you need to implement this, and you're saying like, what's the one? Is it this guy? No, it's the other guy.
Oh, the other guy, okay.
Yeah. And you're saying.
Resolve current tenant identifier.
Current identifier, and it gives you back the string.
Mm-hmm. It basically, so we can look at the implementation that we have, but the very, like the simplest thing probably is you can just inject a session scoped object into the class that implements this interface and just ask the session, which tenant am I? Yeah, that would be the simplest thing. Then you can ask the thread. Then the question becomes, well, what is going to mark the thread? You can have just a filter. So every single request that comes in, you go through the trouble. So you ask the session there, and you just mark the thread.
You could also just like look at who's the current user, consult the database, which tenant is this user.
It's true.
You can't do that until you log in, but you need to know which tenant it is.
Oh.
To
it's probably based on the URL. Basically.
Yes.
No, not if your users were not in a tenant. If your users were independent of the tenant.
Sure, yeah. Is there any service?
Yeah. So maybe that's what, sorry, I misunderstood the question. You're probably asking, how do you actually determine it for the very first time? And yes, we have a sliding sort of algorithm, sliding scale, whatever. We first look at the URL. And typically we would have tenant name dot subdomain. But that's an issue in actually your local development because you work off the local host. So then we would ask the request. Because that's not a big price to ask a developer to just specify a tenant, question mark tenant equals. And then we would check the session, and then we had one more. But typically, yeah, in production, it was URL. Shit. Any other sort of methods that anyone curious? Like, it's more interesting to ask these questions now because, after I show you how we did it, it's... any of the issues that you guys can think about that are still not solved from before? So we got rid of a lot of ugly code because now it's sort of getting a connection, sort of this dispatcher logic is still in one place.
Creating and destroying tenants.
Yes. This freaking out of the box Hibernate support, it still doesn't really help me to dynamically add tenants. It asks for a connection, and now I have to worry about, well, how do I get this connection? Well, I haven't initialized the tenant. So this is the method that we just looked at. Get connection. I identify it as sort of the pinnacle of the multi-tenancy. It really all boils down to going to the right data source and fetching a connection to me. This whole multi-tenancy is really just about that. Unresolved issues. I still cannot introduce new tenants dynamically, which is lame. We have a tenant resolver which tells which tenant is currently running a thread as, okay, whatever, I'm an immigrant. But we can't easily look up resources such as pool and session factory using this the tenant key. I still cannot easily say, okay, I'm running as this customer, give me the connection pool, or give me the session factory. And here, I don't know, actually I'd like to hear if anybody can think of how, you know, some of the approaches. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to dynamically instantiate connection pool and session factory. It's an expensive operation, so once we initialize it, we want to hold on to it. What would be the simplest thing?
You can create your own data source.
Yeah. You create your own data source on the fly. You get the parameters for this data source that tells you how to connect to the correct tenant. And you stick it on the map on a singleton, right? That, like, that should work. So in my get connection, I go to some map, basically, and I say, give me the connection pool for free time cafe. And in that class, I say, if it's not initialized, I'm going to go and I'm going to get, you know, it from somewhere, and I'm going to initialize it, I'm going to put it in the map, and next time I'm just going to return it. This is what we had in the beginning.
Can I just ask you a question?
Yeah.
How often are you thinking, like, in terms of your business, how often are you thinking of adding tenants?
Right. So initially it wasn't often at all. But it's not just signing up a new customer. It's also the issue when I shut down the server and I start it up. No, it is only an issue of, so initially it was not an issue at all. Initially it was not, it once in a couple of months. Right now, actually, this application, it creates dozens and dozens a day. Dozens and dozens of tenants a day. They're not all paying customers, unfortunately, but there are dozens and dozens. Another use case that I can come up with, business case, is a trial. What if somebody comes into my to my website and he just wants to try this app out? And the best thing I can do is send me an email, and in 5 days I'll come back to you. I'll restart the server on Saturday night, and I'll send you an email. And by this time the customer is done.
What about database part? It's for the new customer. It's the same.
Yeah. So we had like a clean slate database, and we had a stored procedure. Again, somebody has to run it.
So at that point, didn't you think that maybe using the discriminator column would be a better approach?
It's funny. So we get flawed. You know, new people come in, and this constantly gets challenged. You know, why did you go with separate database up until this day? Why not go with a schema? It's so much better. And I honestly can passionately defend all this, opposite sides of the spectrum for hours. You tell me which point you want me to defend, and I'll go and I'll defend it. So, yes, it's still, we think about it all the time. It's always a trade-off. Okay, so there's actually one very neat concept that has nothing to do with multi-tenancy that made our life very simple. And it allows us to have get connection method, the method that I call the pinnacle of multi-tenancy, the most important method of the multi-tenancy. This is the real implementation. We basically just ask Spring for a data source. As if it's a non-multi-tenant application, as if it's just a regular application with a single data source. And Spring figures it all out for us using, anybody can think what, it's one of the Spring hooks, I know I did knows. It's one of the Spring hooks, no? What?
I don't know Spring well enough.
Oh, it's this concept of custom scope. So custom scope, Spring out of the box, gives you the session scope, the singleton scope. Oh, shit, thank God it's not an interview. A thread it gives you out of the box. So session, thread, singleton, and request. Thank you. So it gives you these four out of the box. And what we realized is we can implement our own scope, and Spring actually makes it fairly easy. That will be longer than a session but not quite a singleton because we want to kill it while the application is still running. So yeah, I put it longer than a session, shorter than a singleton, but it is attached to a session because the session stores are key. And here, so I'm going to quickly go through that, and that's actually the remaining bit. This is the part that tied it all together for us, because what we looked at before, it's enough to implement multi-tenancy, but it still feels when you work with a customer, you look with the code base, you constantly have to think that you work within the multi-tenancy app. This, remove that. You introduce new features, you never think that this is a multi-tenant app. So this is the interface. This is from the Java doc. This is how they explain it. It provides the ability to get and put objects from any underlying storage mechanism, such as an HTTP session or custom conversation mechanism. This is long. And we're going to look at this interface. In here, all you have to do, there's other methods, there's get, remove, but this is the important one. All you have to do is tell Spring how to get an object by name. So when I ask, or by class, it doesn't matter, but when you ask Spring, give me a data source of scope, let's call it customer, this is how we called it. So it's not a session, it's of this specific scope. When I have an object defined as a scoped customer, and I say, and I ask Spring to give it to me, how do I do that? All the magic goes into here. And I can do whatever I want here. I can still do what you mentioned. I can still instantiate it dynamically, put it in a map. But it's just this mechanism will know about it, and Spring will be completely oblivious. Spring will not know where I got it from. I can still out of wire. I can do everything that Spring allows me to do, as if it's a singleton.
When I mentioned that, I was actually thinking that the data source would look in the thread loop. But that's a different.
I see. So, like, right in the constructor, for example.
No, when you call the get connection.
Oh, I see. So you would do a wrapper around sort of a data source.
But dynamic proxy guide, you know, like that for everything. So.
Yeah. We actually have something like that. So we started with separate session factories per customer. What we realized, the session factory introduces the overhead of about 5 megs, 6 megs per customer, which we don't need. When you have 1,000 customers, it starts to add up.
Yeah.
So we said, well, we don't need actually multiple session factories, which we actually reversed that. We actually do need them because EH cache, now it supports multi-tenancy, but before it would be per session factory, so you still want caching that's associated. Right now it supports it. You have a single EH cache, and there are buckets for each customer. But we try to always make the number of objects that are per customer smaller and smaller. And we do have actually something like that. We do have a proxy.
When you get an object from the scope, what are you trying to get, a deal or what?
It's up to you. So what I mentioned earlier is when you're within the multi-tenant app, you'll have to deal with objects that are specific to each tenant. At the very least, it's going to be a connection pool. So what we're trying to do here is I want to mark certain objects as tenant objects. So typically, let's say you define a user info bean, for example, a user context or whatever, and you mark it as session scope, meaning that every time a customer signs into your web app, Spring will create an instance of that object and it'll assign it to a session. What we're trying to do here is we're trying to assign it to a tenant. And
Customer scope,
exactly. And if we look, and hopefully this will make sense, but if we look here, we basically have a map of maps. We have a tenant identifier, and then in here, we have to have another map because we have data sources, session factories, and some other objects. And all we do when Spring asks to get me some bean, it doesn't pass me the tenant identifier. It just tells me, listen, I need a bean because you asked for it. You out-of-wired something. But we have the get conversation ID, which we implemented, which gets it from the thread. We delegate it to another method. Well, this is our choice. You don't have to do that. But once I have the customer from the thread, I can do whatever I want. I can go to the map. I can go through the initialization logic. which is what we do here. Begin, you know, we're going to get the bean map. We're going to instantiate. If this is the very first time the customer is accessing it, I got to create the map for this customer. I got to bootstrap this customer, which means I got to initiate the pool for it. I got to find out, well, which connection settings, where do I get the connection settings from? And we get it from this dedicated central database. We have a database which tells us what our customers are and how to connect to their databases. The passwords are encrypted. Each database has its own user. So we can do all that messy logic that we were talking about here, but we didn't see it before in here. And then we get all the magic of Spring for free. We never worry about the fact that we're inside the multi-tenant app because of this get method. Everywhere else, I just tell Spring, inject a connection pool.
So when I say get entity manager in my DAO, and it comes here and gets the entity manager, how does that happen?
So
it doesn't get everything from here.
It doesn't get everything from here. So the key is you have to mark your object of this type of scope. So by default, when you... Yeah. So by default, when you define new beans in Spring SML, they're singletons. So that's a separate scope. And it's actually inside Spring, there's something very similar implemented where it holds on to all the references to singletons. If you mark your object as a session, the same thing. There's a map somewhere and it goes here. It would only go here if I'm accessing an object of type customer or tenant. And we had, you know, three or four of those. Any other questions here? This is, again, to get bean map. Okay, so here, it's very simple. It's map of maps. So the first time, we just got to create the map for this tenant.
I'm just checking synchronization.
Yeah, synchronization. Yeah, so synchronization, unfortunately, so it's a bit of a pain because when I ask for tenant scoped session factory, I cannot just have this block synchronized and nothing else enter it. So we said, well, we're just going to do it per customer. But we have this catch-22 issue. Well, session factory is going to ask for data source of this same tenant. So it's got to be re-entrant, because while I'm initializing session factory for this tenant, I got to initialize connection pool for this tenant. So I got to make sure that this method getBean can enter multiple times in the same stack. I think we have all the sort of synchronization. It's a balance between performance and, you know, yeah, playing it safe. But you know, for us, it basically boiled down to this. And, you know, once we figured out how to lock it, what our scope of sort of synchronization is, we just go to bootstrap customer. And here, there's a class somewhere. Initialize pool. Here we're just initializing the pool dynamically. This customer DB properties, they come from central database, and once we do this, we basically solve that initial issue that we had, and we can destroy it. We can initialize it. We're not paying the overhead of. We're still paying the overhead of multiple objects. They're just in one place. The answer is, based on what they give you out of the box, customer scope was just sort of the last kind of cherry, you know, the cherry in the pie. Is that the saying? I don't know. It was this, the last bit that made it, because, yeah, out of the box, they give you all these mechanisms, but we still had ugly code. We still had that logic somewhere. It was basically implemented this way. But we couldn't do Spring wiring easy, and this allows us to do it. So to me, yes, the answer is go with Spring and Hibernate, use the out-of-the-box support, and implement the custom scope. It just, again, if I show you the typical DAO or a typical service, you'll never know you're within the multi-tenant app. And everything's out-of-wired, everything is, you know, of this, you know, tenant scope, certain objects. You were saying you were a proxy guy, right? Sorry, I didn't catch your name, but...
Dell,
okay. If I can find it... So you need this. It's funny. You can do everything right, but if you don't have the annotation saying that this is a proxy, injecting it still won't work. But this is, again, nothing to do with multi-tenancy. You would have to do that even if it was a session. If you are auto-wiring a session into some class, which is a singleton, you have to actually inject a session, a proxy. All right, so that's it. I'm just going to wrap up. Tying it all together, basically, that I'm saying that, my God, like, it solved our problems. Life is good. And it's actually now pleasant to work on this application. And here, a few rough edges. So there's still a lot of bugs in Spring and Hibernate when it comes to multi-tenancy. The biggest one that I think is each cache works. You can have second-level cache with multi-tenancy support, sort of. If I want to evict, before multi-tenancy, I could evict an object by ID. I can say, this entity with ID 1, go and evict it from cache. When I do this, it will work, but it will evict the entire region. It will evict all the entities, for example, users, for all the tenants. And it's a bug, actually. They don't ask the conversation ID. They ask it when they put it, but not when you're evicting. JTA Transaction Manager. Yeah, it really is a shame, but you got to have it. And again, we used Atomicos, and believe it or not, we actually implemented our own. Not me, but we had a really smart guy that implemented a spec, implemented a GTA transaction manager that's custom. It's very fast, tailored to our needs. Yes?
That's regardless of using the database
yes.
or the schema?
Yeah. Oh, or the schema. This is a good question. I don't know. I would assume, my suspicion would be that the answer, I'm not sure about the schema, but the shared, no, you wouldn't need a separate, you wouldn't need a JTA. Because the whole issue of JTA transaction is multiple, well, it's multiple things, but it's at least the issue that we ran into here is multiple data sources. It's not the job of a transaction manager that comes with Spring to really handle multiple resources, even if you don't need XA. You guys know XA? It's basically a distributed transaction. But it's a very good question. I suspect that it wouldn't be an issue because you basically go into the same database. There's nothing special. That's very good. So Atomicos, you don't have to. So Atomicos worked for us, but it really sucked performance-wise. Atomicos one is the XA one. So it supports distributed transaction, but it went through all the trouble of assuming that it's going to be a distributed transaction. And in our case, we never had distributed transactions. We only would only talk to one database at a time. And it wasn't my decision, but the new one is really, really fast. Of course, now that this person is gone, we have to maintain it. Everybody's scared to touch this code. Well, okay, so when Spring and Hibernate support came out, I never asked the question in the simple way. I always start with this story. But I submitted like 6 or 7 bugs that just got no attention. So at some point, I just stopped.
You guys didn't like say, well, instead of implementing a JTA transaction manager, we'll try to just implement it in Spring.
Oh, no, we tried that. So we tried class shadowing. We took the Spring Transaction Manager and we tried to hack it.
Yeah.
That didn't go anywhere. But the other guy was a lot smarter than me, so he went this route and it worked. I was just happy. But yeah, there's still open bugs that I opened like 5 years ago, especially the evicting one, because it's a huge performance hit. I just want to evict. I can argue that in a well-designed application, you never have to evict entities, but the reality is just not, yeah.
Beyond what we're talking about here, but I'm curious how you guys handle upgrading. And if you're doing like a major upgrade and you want to maybe bring 5 or 10 clients up just to see how the upgrade goes.
We have a pretty good test coverage. We have unit tests, database tests, integration tests, and Selenium WebDriver.
If you have over 1,000 databases.
Yeah.
Oh,
so for schemas. Okay, for schemas, we use Liquid Base. So Yes, there's a script that basically does this. You have to iterate through every single database and you execute a script on it.
But that must take time, no?
It takes time. Right now, and again, sort of, you know, right now things are better. We're in a multi-clustered environment. We're running active-active. So we can shut down, you know, one instance, update this database in one application, redirect traffic to another one, make sure the traffic dies here. The ops guys do that, but that's how they tell me they do it. What I thought you were asking is how we, when you said upgrading, I thought you meant frameworks, and that's a challenge. When you upgrade Spring and Hibernate, our entire test coverage and everything, it's still single tenant. We're not actually testing multi-tenancy, and it's very difficult to test. So we sort of upgrade Spring and Hibernate, we cross our fingers, run automated tests, okay, automated tests work, but it doesn't prove that isolation is still there. So, you know, manual testing and stuff there. No, we do other things. I'm not saying we just cross our fingers and go to production. Initially, we cross our fingers, but then we do our due diligence. And yeah, if you know, if there are any more questions, but yeah.
Can I test it out? You said that there is a free account just to see how it works in the real.
Oh, the application. So the trial was okay. So this application now. Where did my oh. So it got acquired, the startup got acquired, and it now called PLM 360. So you just type in PLM 360, you land on this page, and here's just gonna tell you how amazing it is, and and when I said the trial, I used it as an example, as a business case. How you actually get a trial now that we are part of this billion-dollar corporation, I have no idea. Go. 30-day trial. There you go. Oh no, it's funny. I don't control like these controls because you know we implement the back office. I don't have access to a production back office.
Huh?
Oh yeah, yeah. I could, sure. Yeah, yeah. I could. I'll say I'm not gonna admit it in a room like that that I would do this, but yeah, you can do that. So there you go. There's a 30-day trial. You can register now, and yeah, for 30 days you can play around with it. We only covered the multi-tenancy, but it actually the app sits on top of a pretty cool meta engine. You can model your business processes. It's actually very similar to Salesforce, very very similar. Just trying to address slightly different business need.
So
yeah.
Why might XA be required in the last one in your slide there? Or anything
like that? So, right. So, the issue is, so I very briefly mentioned, I didn't want to spend too much time on it, is the fact that we have this central super database that tells us where the customers are, which data center, et cetera, et cetera. Technically, when we initialize a customer, we do an XA transaction. I want it to be distributed because If you go and you start a trial, I want to go to the central database, check, okay, do I have a tenant with this name? I don't. It served the record there. Now go and try to create these data sources, initialize them, do all sorts of stuff. I want to roll back. We do that basically through our own multi-phase rollback and commit. We don't use XA right now, but you probably, in a multi-tenant application, if you want to have this storage of tenants, you probably won that.
So this multi-tenancy is where you would use it where you have n customers and n is large. Because if it's very small, then your infrastructure group or your SCM group wants to use VMware to spin up boxes and just copy things around.
That's a good question, yeah. So for us, it was scalability. I guess, yeah, the number of customers is really, really small. I wouldn't go through the trouble of trying to, you know, and if we were talking about data sets and try to identify what your typical customer is. If you know you're going to have few very large customers, yeah, I'd still probably just dump WARs and have them go through there and have some sort of a, you know, master config file. It makes sense when you have n large and regardless of whether the customers are small or big, it's when the n is large, yeah.
Because those are completely automating the starting up virtual machines like in microseconds, like less than a second, you'll have a full machine up and running with its own database, its own Tomcat, its own whatever is
in it. Really, like in seconds? Like, do you really mean that?
Like seconds, yeah, like literally seconds. And CoreOS is a distribution of Linux that is optimized for like having thousands and thousands of instances and updating them and running your own cloud. So there's a lot of innovation happening in the infrastructure there, which weren't there probably when you started out, right?
Yeah, we still do that. We still have multiple VMs, multiple clusters, and you know, we have thousands of tenants and of multi-tenant. We still have multiple wars, actually. We have multiple wars sitting on multiple machines, but they're pointing to their own thousands of customers. So we have sort of multi-tenancy on top of the infrastructure multi-tenancy. Sorry.
Basic question.
A
customer wants several databases, like several connection partners.
If customer wants several databases,
yeah.
What do you mean by that? So why not? So if you are the customer and you want three databases, I would tell you, well, we'll give you three tenants. Would that address you need?
So customer can have several
tenants. I mean, it's really so the scope of a tenant is the users, and the data. So if you're fine with your data not being shared across three instances, we would just give you. In our case, each customer is mapped to one tenant. But just listen, if you have the money, you can.
Spring.
Yeah.
In the very beginning, you put the type of database you use. It's database or schema or something. If you provide the connection, why do you need to? Why Spring requires actually this type of database you use? You know, that's it has connection. Who cares? It's schema or database or whatever it is.
That's a good question. You're basically saying that why do I have to explicitly tell Hibernate, so that was a Hibernate config file,
okay, Hibernate, yeah.
That I went with a database model when at the end it gets, that's a very good question. I'm not sure, I would have to look at the code to see what it actually affects that token.
It's a historical reason. You start with Hibernate and then you move to other connections.
No, because what he's saying,
per connection.
So what he's saying here, and that's actually, I like that question.
Thank you.
So, no, it definitely makes sense. He's saying, well, why do I have to do this if at the end, Hibernate is still going to ask me for this method, and it's going to call get connection. And in here, it doesn't really matter whether it's database or, because I have to go through the trouble of fetching the right connection. And this is a good question. I'm not sure. I would have to look at the source code. I would have to look at the session initialization and see.
Well, it has to add, if it's a shared schema, it has to add the tenant ID, you know, or there's some even your code mark is tenant. I played with it once a long time ago, but it might.
If it's a shared, so suppose you selected shared, Hibernate would still, when it came time to talk to the database, it would still land on this method, and it would be up to you to do whatever you want to get at the right connection.
No, I know, but when it does this query from my memory,
that might be it.
With tenants?
So I'm not getting it.
So he is saying that, well, I think what you're saying is the Hibernate query, when it translates from, let's say, criteria, when it translates the query into SQL, it might need to know whether the schema, when it's a dedicated database or whether it's a separate schema, because you might have to generate SQL differently. That might be it. Yeah. So it will actually affect the translation, generation of the SQL. Yeah.
Because it will qualify with a different schema.
Yeah.
Different columns.
They're probably protecting you. Really.
Yeah. Because here you gave the connection, but you didn't give the SQL. SQL is still, yeah. Yeah, that's very good. Yeah. So we migrated from SQL Server to Postgres, and it took 9 months and a team of people. So we support one database.
How many months?
Nine. It's really? Yeah, it was a long and painful process. Legacy code, lots of customizations that happened to be stored procedures. If everything was implemented in Hibernate, which it's not, and I am committing it, then theoretically we just change the dialect. But we have tons of SQL code, just a ton. I didn't.
From one database to other database, just as a continuation to the question, sorry.
So why would we move? Licensing costs, well, I think was the biggest one. So once you start scaling SQL Server, it's not that expensive, it scales well, but the licensing cost was big. And we wanted the JSON support. In Postgres, you can actually dump your JSON object and you can join on JSON objects. You can index columns within JSON objects as if it's a properly denormalized database. And that's...
What version of Postgres were you doing that on?
Shit. I really should know that. I was not there. So I'm a consultant, so I come back. So I was not there, thankfully, for the migration. 9.2. Sorry, I missed that.
I'm saying there are so many technical questions, you better share the code and the
system. Oh, yeah. I love it. No, let me close that. No, I gotta do that.
you might as well tell us about the security problems, SQL injection.
Security, listen. Yeah, it's, yeah, so this again, the cross-tenant contamination that we talked about it, you would think that if you went with a separate database, all your problems, but no. In the application code, we go through all sorts of trouble to ensure that if you mark the thread once, nobody can override the thread. Of course, a developer can still go and remove that security. It's just, it's really not that hard. And then recently, somebody came and there was a real business need where you actually need to do that. When you want to execute operations against a different database while you're in that one. And that's... business need meaning they came up with a feature that sort of makes sense and we have to implement it. So, yeah, NSA business need. I didn't get it. Yeah. So, but it's funny. You know, it might as well could have been maybe. But we actually had to break some of the security restraints that we built because we need to. But listen, you guys want to, I don't want to bore you with this. Your data is totally safe. But do create a unique password when you sign up for the trial. So, it just so happened it almost like a marketing. I'm going to tell my boss to pay me maybe for. Any more questions?
If someone breaks tomorrow in the week, you know where to search.
That's it. And again, send your bill to Adib. He was generous enough to.
Done.
I know. All right, that's what do I do? Like, well, thank you.